Let's remain silent for 2 minutes. Mind may have been distracted by the discussions over tea that you may have had. For a minute or two, do some gentle breath observation. Bring the mind back to yourself, collect it back by taking the support of breathing. Narayanena Swayam व्यासेन ग्रथितां पुराण मुनिना मध्ये महाभारतं अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणीं अष्टादशाध्यायिनीं अम्बत्वा गीते भवद्वेषिणीं नमोस्तुते व्यास विशाल बुद्धे पुल्लारविन्दायत पत्र नेत्र येन त्वया भारत प्रज्वालितो ज्ञानमय प्रदीप प्रपन्न पारिजाताय स्तोत्र वेत्रैकपाणये ज्ञानमुद्राय कृष्णाय गीतामृतदुहे नमः। द बॉडी इज ऑल देयर इज टू लाइफ, दिस इज ऑल देयर इज नथिंग मोर। लाइक इन कठोपनिषद वी हैड द एक्सप्रेशन अयम लोकः न परः। There is only this world and nothing more. That was Arjuna's vision. Though Arjuna was otherwise well read, you and I also are well read, but how many times we forget, especially when we are face to face with some challenges. Intense moments, a whole lot of our bookish knowledge doesn't come to our help. We act in ways that are worse than even some utterly illiterate, uneducated people of villages or so. Very many times we get such examples of well-placed people doing such mistakes that you would not expect from even villagers. Why does that happen? We do not have, number one, reminders, or more than just plain information reminders, we do not have some inputs of inspiration, not just information, but we need inspiration, then we go up. Therefore, it was said not just Kshatriya but Brahmanista would be needed. An inferior teacher would not be successful. It was said in the Kathopanishad. By the way, this is not for you and me to judge some teacher. Inferior dikhte hai, inferior lagta hai, and so on. Nor does it mean that to go and learn from anybody and everybody. From our point of view or on our part, we need to have an open mind. We should not judge anybody either way, but with an open mind we keep learning, and objectively, nothing to say about the person, but the material or the process or the instruction methodology the atmosphere, the general vibrations, the ambience, general feeling that you get is not all that satisfying for whatever reason, then you are open means that you are ready to withdraw also, you are ready to go further too. The Upanishad only states a matter of fact. For this out of the way matter called transformation, after all, cannot take place anywhere and everywhere. Therefore, the Upanishad, there is no wonder, stipulates some conditions, shart. Mundaka Upanishad says Brahmanishtaha and Shrotriyaha. Kata Upanishad said na avarena proktaha, avarena proktaha siddhyati or something, avara meaning inferior. Ananyena prokte gatiratra nasti. That was the punchline. If someone who is totally identified with this truth comes in your life, then you are like somebody caught in the jaws of a tiger. Then you once more, there is no, what should I do doesn't arise. You would just get going and you hardly have any choice. There are examples or inspiring stories of some teacher-student relationships where the student ran away. He could run away only to come back after a little while. So, from the jaws of the tiger, the prey could fall only to be picked up again. Call it some viveka on the part of the student, or it was the compassion or grace of the teacher. But when we get to know such stories, our eyebrows go up, oh really, and once more we get humbled, the sense of free will that we can run away if we want or we can stay if we want, sense of free will gets falsified. The sense of it's in our hands, it's up to us, that's what is called free will, right? I am the architect of my future and so on, that is free will. Everything is decided by a higher intelligence, is the theory of destiny. Which is true is hard to say. And there are theories in support of all possibilities. There are theories of you are the maker of your tomorrow. Lord Krishna himself says, Uddhared Atmana Atmanam. You should lift yourself by yourself in chapter 6. He says, Atmaiva Atmano Banduhu, Atmaiva Ripur Atmana. If there is a great friend for you, that is you yourself. If there is the worst enemy for you, that is also you yourself. This is a strong argument in favor of willpower or free will, self-effort. And somewhere else, same Lord Krishna has said, I move this whole universe, yantra rudhani mayaya, like puppets fixed on some machines. You turn the switch on, the machine moves, and as per the program of the machine, the puppets also move. And somewhere else there are indirect indications of a combination. Life is a joint venture between Jiva and Ishvara. Whatever ratio, 2 cents and 98 cents, or other way, Swami Chinmayananji gave an analogy where it is a joint venture, combination. You are going on a boat where you are also rowing and you also have what you call this motor. You are rowing, you are motor, that is what you do. But then the current in the river could be favorable or unfavorable. So, how your boat will move is a combination, is the net result of the current of the river and your rowing or your effort through the motor. And he gave those wonderful, well worded pieces of advice. Your tomorrow is your yesterday as modified by your today. So, your yesterday is theory of destiny, but as modified by your today, meaning by what you do today, is the theory of free will. So, your tomorrow, that is your future, is the net result of what has been decided and then what you do. Apparently, what you do can slightly modify, slightly also sometimes can be a lot or can be less, case by case. God appeared in the dream of somebody, and even as he appeared, the man said, I was waiting to get you, you know, get to meet you. I have a doubt. God said, yes, tell me, what's your doubt? The man said, I don't see any purpose or any reason for me to exert anymore, for I have read or heard that you have written it all down. What will happen in my life? God said, that is true. I have written everything down. Ah, you said it now. If you have written everything down, what is in it? What is there in it for me to do? God said, yeah, but you do not know that in that document which I have written, some places there is a phrase, as you choose, as you please, as you like. There is a clause. So there it comes in your hands. This is another way of putting that apparently you have some choice. We do not know. And I must complete the discussion with the third possibility, where both are dismissed, neither free will nor destiny. All this is nonsense. And no one less than Sri Ramana Maharshi said that to say it is free will and to say it is all destined are both signs of ignorance. The truth is, there is neither free will nor destiny. He said, what does it mean? Yeah, there is no agent here at all whose future has to be decided. There is nobody really whose tomorrow has to be talked about. This entity, this person, this man or woman about whom there is so much discussion, now what will happen to her tomorrow? Now what will happen to her or him day after tomorrow? This is the question. Maharshi Ramana's viewpoint is the highest. There is no person at all, it's an illusion. Will the snake move away or should we kill it? Maybe the snake will go away on its own. No, no, this is all just idle hope. You must do something. You should chase it away. So, long discussion is going on, and then comes along somebody who grins and says, Bhaiyo or Behno, there is no snake here, and it throws a beam of light, there is only a rope. So, Maharshi says, don't waste so much time on concerns about your future. Yoga kshema dranite, right? See, it all connects together. What will happen to me? Now I am young, but when I get old? Now I have my spouse, but when, suppose he or she goes away first, Now there is a godfather for me. Now there is somebody on whom I lean. But if that person goes like that, you know, all of us worry. It is said, instead of wasting time in this speculation, kal kya hoga, spend the same energy into this inquiry, who am I? Kal mera kya hoga is the question. Ye mera hai kya? Well, it is in form of mai. Or therefore, mai hu kya? Who am I? But some people don't do self-inquiry because they feel that all fun is gone then. There's a lot of fun here, anxiety. Lot of, you know, like people like horror movies, like this, they like to suffer. If you do inquiry, all your problems will be solved, says the guru. And these are that kind of people who say, that is why we don't want to do self-inquiry. Because if all problems are solved, then what's the, what's the fun? What's the use of life? So, this is called kutarka, crooked arguments. Sri Krishna, we said, takes Arjuna to a higher point of view, where without at this moment dismissing the existence itself of the body, it is all the same said that body is only like clothes. You throw away old clothes and wear new clothes. Do not make a big issue of it. You are not the clothes. You are the body in the analogy. And in the theme proper, you are not the body, you are the soul. Tata sharirani vihaya anyani sanyati hu dehi. In Sanskrit, deha is the body, dehi is the indwelling spirit. And with respect to this indwelling spirit, let this be said, nainam chindanti shastrani. Nainam dahati pavakaha.
Nainam dahati pavakaha.
Nachainam kledayantyapaha.
Nachainam kledayantyapaha.
Nashoshayati marutaha.
Nashoshayati marutaha.
Achhedyoyamadahyoyam. Akledyo shoshya eva cha. Nitya sarvagata sthanuhu. Achaloyam sanatanaha. Let's lead together both the shlokas. Nainam
chindanti shastrani. Nainam dahati pavakaha, na chainam kedayantyapaha, na shoshayati marutaha, achedyoyamadayoyam, akvedyo shoshya evacha, nitya sarvagatastanuhu, achaloyam sanatanaha.
Shastrani enam na chindanti. No weapon can cut this pure self. As we already pointed out, while it is true for the Jivatma, which is pure Satchidananda reflected in mind, body, senses, pranas and so on, which we refer to as the transmigrating soul, though it applies to the Jivatma, the main focus or what Sri Krishna primarily is conveying here is the pure self, that is pure Satchidananda, unconnected with body and mind, with Sukshma Sharira also, right? The three levels, please remember or contemplate upon the three levels the pure eye plus subtle level that goes from one body to another, then the pure level plus the subtle level as housed in a gross body. Instead of the sun up in the sky for a change, go back, revisit the metaphor of Viveka Chudamani with space, Akash. Space is all pervading, one without a second. Then there is water in the bucket, then there is the bucket. Three levels. The bucket is very limited, of a fixed form, fixed shape. The water is something that can move, goes into another bucket and takes the shape of the container. It is more flexible, it is fluid. Fluid has become a synonym for flexibility. Sometimes they say the situation is a little fluid now, meaning it may change any time. There is the bucket, there is the water, then there is space. There is the body, there is the transmigrating jivatma, subtle body, and there is the shuddha atma. Upanishads and the essential teachings of the Vedanta are concerned with the shuddha atma. That is never born, that never changes, it's everywhere. Where is the question of going from one place to another? A crow can leave one branch of the tree, fly and go and sit on another branch of the tree. Can space do that? Space leaving one branch and reaching another branch. Space is already everywhere. In like manner, the pure self is all pervasive, has no sin or merit, ever pure. Therefore, we say Nitya Shuddha, Nitya Buddha, Nitya Mukta, and so on. And this mantra can be interpreted not on the level of the body. Body can be cut into pieces by weapons, body can be burnt by fire, you can make the body wet, as the wife of Socrates did once to her husband. When she got very angry and yelled at him and screamed at him and khub gali diya, he was lost in some thought, he did not respond. Then she went and brought a bucket of water, poured it upon his head. So Abhisheka is not only Hindu practice. The Greeks, ancient Greeks also practiced Abhisheka as a ritual. So she put a bucket of water on him. Then Socrates said in Shuddha Hindi, "Ke kya kar rahe ho? Kya kar rahe ho?" Wife said, "What else should I do?" Then he said, okay. Then he smiled and said, "Well, it is once more proved. After thunder, there is rain. After thunder, there is rain." So he said. So she actually conducted an exercise, experiment in the context of verse 23 of chapter 2. Kledayanti apaha. Apaha means water. Can water make the body wet? Of course, yes. But can water make the soul wet? Krishna says no. Nainam kledayanti apaha. So this soul could be the conditioned soul that also cannot be made wet by water, or the unconditioned, undivided, all pervasive soul. And this portion is primarily to talk about that Shuddha Atma. That is where you get moksha. If you realize jivatma status of yours, you don't get moksha. Well, but you may be more intelligent. You know more than many others who, for whom there is only physical body. So, sthul sharir ke sivai kuch hai nahi unko. Aap jante hain ki ek sukshma sharir hai. Not by just bookish ways, but you have, let us say, some experience. Those who do OBE, out of body experience they gain. Some people not consciously or by their effort, but whatever, accidentally, they do leave their body. They go up in there, they see their own body, and after some time they re-enter. It has happened with many people. In England, OBE means Order of the British Empire, equivalent to Padma Shri or Padma Bhushan or something. Many people, I know one lady in London, she comes to Varanasi, recently she was there. Her card shows, name OBE. I first thought she had out of body experience perhaps, but why is she putting it in her visiting card? Then later I came to know she has received a civilian award from the Queen of England, which is called Order of the British Empire, for outstanding social service she has done. Being herself a lady of Asian origin, from Punjab originally, she has done lot of service for especially women, Asian women, whether they are Filipinos or Indians, Bangladeshis or Vietnamese, doesn't matter. She did a lot, and the British government recognized her services on some occasion, like we have Republic Day and so on, some occasion day. The Britishers are unfortunate, they don't celebrate Independence Day. One Britisher came, and when all were celebrating, he felt, we are not fortunate to celebrate. You know, everything doesn't belong to everybody. Huh? So, OBE, those who have out of body experience, or those who have certain other powers also. And sometimes, you know, people die and then they come back. There are reports given in various magazines. Of course, some of you may not believe in them. You may say all that is cock and bull story. That's different. But many believe in it. They experience going through some tunnel and varieties of things. And for some reason, which they also do not know, they are back in the body. That is called NDE, near death experience. Near death, they almost died, or they died but came back. It seems sometimes there are computer errors in heaven also. A soul goes and then they find, then they send that soul back, provided the body is not yet cremated and so on. If the body is cremated, then there are perhaps other ways of compensation. Lot of compensation is given to those souls for the error committed, whatever way. Just like if it's not your fault, but a plane did not take you, there are airlines sometimes overbook. You have booked your ticket 2 months back, and they gave away tickets to 300 people while seats are only 280. And they think that there will be, of course, 20 cancellations. Cancellations take, but for some reason no cancellations. So all of you go there, then they apologize. We sincerely apologize, but please see our terms and conditions. They have a provision. For our own reasons, we may sometimes not have somebody board the plane, but we will compensate appropriately. So they gave you a free ticket for any other plane as well as a cash compensation. This is done in many countries. So you get sometimes a handsome amount. If the plane ticket, let us say, is 5,000 rupees, the compensation itself may be 8000 rupees plus you get another flight also, or sometimes they give you 5-star accommodation and so on, free food, everything, and compensation, so many things. So the souls also similarly, you know, some compensation is given, a free round of heaven. Anyhow, you have come up to here by mistake, stick around, and then afterwards they put him back on the earth in some other body, you know. So there are so many ways, you know. It's quite a big science, vast science. So the subtle body you may come to know, but it doesn't, my main point is knowledge of your subtle body, that you are not this gross body alone, you are something other than the gross body, doesn't give you moksha. You need to have further deeper insight, where you say, I am not even the mind, not even the, in a manner of saying, I am not something separable from rest of creation. That is the meaning of non-duality. I am not separate from the tree or the chair, I am not separate from her or him. There is no separation. I am that which knows no division, no boundary. The pure I am, which Nisargadatt Maharaj would say, I am that. The pure I am has no boundary at all. No male, no female, no, not old, not young, not big, not small. Or if you want a more poetic language, bigger than the biggest, smaller than the smallest. That expression will come later in both here and other places. Wind cannot turn you dry. And achedyaha, adahyaha, akledyaha, shoshyaha is a repetition. Then says, Lord says, nityaha, eternal or timeless, sarvagataha, being everywhere, sthanuhu, staying firm, achalaha, unmoving, I am sanatanaha, most ancient and yet ever new. Avyaktoyam achintyoyam,
avyaktoyam achintyoyam,
avikaryoyam uchyate,
avikaryoyam uchyate,
tasmadevam viditvainam,
tasmadevam viditvainam,
nanushochitum arhasi,
nanushochitum arhasi,
avyaktoyam achintyoyam, avikaryoyam uchyate, tasmadevam viditvainam, nanushochitum arhasi, atha chainam nitya jatam,
atha chainam nitya jatam,
nityam va manyase mritam,
nityam va manyase mritam,
tathapi tvam mahabaho,
tathapi tvam mahabaho,
naivam shochitum arhasi,
naivam shochitum arhasi,
atha chainam
nitya jatam, nityam va manyase mritam,
tathapi
tvam mahabaho, naivam shochitum arhasi.
Avyaktah, generally, or why generally, all along you and I think of ourselves as, of course, well known, I am this, standing before the mirror, or otherwise also we are self-conscious, we are vyakta, we are manifest, we are expressed, self-expressed. But the inner truth of ours is ever unexpressed. It never is objectified or objectifiable. It can never be seen or heard. The truth that you and I really are, as per Lord Krishna's revelation, he reveals to us this truth. He lets us know, this is the truth. Take it or leave it. Revelations are like that. Thing in Hindi there is a word for exposure, exposing something, khulasa, right? Khulasa. So far it was hidden, chupa hua tha. Some investigative journalists maybe, or some others, they go and open it. Watergate, and so many gates came later. Watergate was one khulasa, one exposure. Richard Nixon, no one less than president of the most prosperous country, got exposed for bugging telephone lines and I don't know what else, rigging elections maybe. So certain wrongs that he had done. So the journalists open it up, expose it, they give all information. Then public and the machinery of law has to do what it has to do. They say this is what we are telling you. Janch kar lo, find out is true or not. Vedanta is something like that. Vedanta say you are Atma, you have no death. Go into it, or you can take CID reports and put it in the shelf, put it in into a cupboard, lock it up and say to the CID or inspector or whoever bought it, thank you very much, bahut acha kaam kiya, I am transferring you to Andaman and Nicobar. That way also it is done sometimes. Rather than rewarding, you punish the investigators. Journalists are fired sometimes for bringing out some reports where maybe the very highly placed members of a society are exposed. First the chief editor congratulates, says, you got all this, you got photographs also, complete proof. Now we have to give you a very high award and all that. The journalist was very happy. But meanwhile, the politicians, the well-placed people, highly, the whole network operates. And the chief editor gets a phone call from the owner of the newspaper. Don't publish that. Hold it back. No, but this journalist, she has done great work. First thing is fire her. So the chief editor also is helpless sometimes. If you don't fire her and keep these reports under lock and key, I am coming in the morning 10 o'clock, give it to me, whole thing. No copies to be made. And collect anything else that this journalist has. Collect all of it and then fire her. This is the order that comes in this wretched world. Honest people are not paid heed to sometimes, right? So that's a different issue. In fact, this Vedanta report also is like that. You and I are behaving like that vested interest. What? We are supposed to be Atma? Very interesting. But the Gita, lock it up. Immediately, Upanishads, Bhagavad Gita, Ramayana, Mahabharata, etc. Maybe we will open it after next Tuesday. After my daughter's marriage is over and my grandson goes to this, we have some milestones. After that, we will again take a look at this report. I see, I am not born. But I was told a grandson was born to me. If I am not born, how can I have a grandson born? I am very attached to my social identity, worldly identity. I am this body. See, as the body, I have a grandson. But Gita says, you are not the body. No one is born, no one dies, and this is devastating. You don't like this report. So you are very much similar to those people who suppress information, who move heaven and earth. Nixon and recently Bill Clinton, and in different ways, they tried to suppress evidence, distort information, bamboozle or deceive, dupe the whole society. Bill Clinton for quite a good length of time succeeded in deceiving even his own wife and daughter. Hillary and Chelsea also for some time believed. They are all politically harassing my husband or our papa, they thought. But finally they had to agree. And I am warning all of you, your effort at suppressing the revelation of Bhagavad Gita will also meet with the same destiny. Kab tak kheloge bhai? Lord Krishna ke saath kheloge? Ye lamba khel, lamba nahi chalega ye khel. Satyameva jayate. Finally, Sri Krishna will win, he will succeed, and you will, with tears of, it won't be tears of sorrow, with tears of joy, you will say, hum haar gaye, aap jeet gaye, ab hum pure ke pure swikar karte hain. I agree, I confess, I admit, I am the indestructible self. But till then, what resistance you give? Sixth camp, no change in anybody, including the speaker. Huh? You don't let chapter after chapter, Upanishad after Upanishad reveal. Khulasa, uske baad ek aur khulasa. All evidence has been heaped up to show that you are not the body, you are the pure self. But like the worst crooks of the world, people look at it, karne do, inka kya kaam hai, let them do, but apan to sharir pakad ke hi rakhenge, we remain in the body. Avyaktaha, achintyaha, unthinkable, beyond thought, avikaryaha, I will not comment much because you all know it in your heart. But you have been pretending not to know. Attending every camp is one more pretending. One more time you want to, hum nahi jante, kuch nahi jante hum. Aisa hai kya? Achha, hum atma hai. Pata hi nahi tha humko. Bahut hi, natak bahut karte hain aap log. To ye is par jyada commentary karna murkhta hai. हमको उल्लू बना रहे हैं आप लोग वाइल नोइंग एवरीथिंग दैट्स व्हाट दे डू समटाइम्स इन लॉट ऑफ दिस क्रिमिनल केसेस द पर्सन नोज एवरीथिंग बट व्हेन इंस्पेक्टर्स कम एंड अदर्स कम एंड आस्क आई डोंट नो एनीथिंग यू नो वेर यू देयर दैट नाइट व्हेन द मर्डर टुक प्लेस मर्डर इन दिस हाउस व्हाट हुज मर्डर व्हाट वे हु आई वे All that you say. आपने ही वो चाकू लेकर घुसाया था, you know. But you act. It's like that. This is not talking about anybody. It's not talking about everyone. You are avyakta. You are avikarya. You are unthinkable, of course. What is it? You are avikarya. Nobody can change you. You know, he will say, he will agree. 40 साल कोशिश किया है, 25 साल, 28 साल, whatever years. Every spouse will agree. Yes, this applies to my wife, avikarya. This applies to my husband. 30 साल से हम देख रहे हैं, कुछ भी नहीं बदले हैं. उसीलिए कैंप में ले आ रहे हैं. अभी देखते हैं. आपके कृपा से. Maybe with your magic wand, you may at last change my spouse. In many camps, when two spouses come, no, I can know from their face. One has come on his or her own. The other has come because this has pulled him or her. Very, very patiently, 5-6 days they stay. No gender bias. It sometimes it could be husband, sometimes it could be wife. So they come, and they don't. How do I know what is the face? Typically, there is a delay of 2 seconds in their laughter. because they are not here at all. So when a joke is cracked, they don't laugh. And when the spouse laughs, they also laugh. Because the whole camp they are attending for the spouse's sake. You know. So anyway, I am getting more ideas, I will not. However, now on verse 26, not an iota of doubt Sri Krishna has, he knows it fully, but he employs another argument. In spite of all this, Arjuna, suppose you still think that you die, nitya jatam, nityam mritam. You die, nityam means again and again here, not every day. Again and again, there is death, suppose you say. It could be about one particular person or every day somebody or the other is dying, there is death every day. So, what it means is, if you take death to be real, which I am not accepting, then also there is no reason for you to cry. Natvam shochitum arhasi, naivam shochitum arhasi, mahabaho, O mighty armed. You may have noticed when we chant at many places, like this 25th verse, avyaktoyam achintyoyam. No, not this one, let's say earlier one. No, I am trying to give you an example where at the end of a quarter, 19. Ubhau tau na vijanito. And by, when we split the sandhi, we make it ubhau tau na vijanitaha. So, some student in our class did that here also. Tatapitvam mahabahaha. But it is not so. Here, mahabaho does not become mahabahaha. Because this is a different word, Mahabahu, and this is Sambodhana, they say. Sambodhana is vocative case. O Mahabahu, you want to say in Sanskrit, it becomes O. But many other places that Vijanitaha or Krishnaha becomes Krishno, Ramaha becomes Ramo, then followed by what we call soft consonant. There's some grammar. These are grammar jokes. Like there was a student called Krishtina in Purushottamananji's batch. That time I was an assistant and I was teaching some Sanskrit. I was teaching some grammar. Krishtina from San Francisco was very eager. She wanted, when we told her this is a 2-year course, she was disappointed. I wanted liberation in 1 year. Why did you that kind of spirit? She was very eager. And she was working very hard, but unfortunately, things did not work out well for her. She left within 6 months or 1 year, I think. But she came and said to me, please teach me Sunday rules. Sunday rules are not clear to me. See, that time my English also was very weak. I had neither traveled abroad. Nor in India also I had not come across enough city people. My English was highly with the, you know, interior Karnataka. I went and told him like that language. Like Kolaveri, what is it? Some song has come. Kolaveri Di. Huh? One song, Kolaveri Di. That song has lot of this Indian Kannada. Indian? English, sorry. Indian accent English. So, my own English was like that and hers was San Francisco, California English. So, partly it was her pronunciation and partly my inability to catch the way Westerners speak English. But three times, Sunday rules. I said, but rules are the same on Sunday and Monday. In Sanskrit, we don't have separate rules for Sunday. No. I mean, Sandhi rules. Oh, Sandhi. Swara Sandhi, Vyanjana Sandhi, Visarga Sandhi, Sandhi rules. Okay, yeah, yeah, please come on, let us sit down. So we went to a corner. I said, A plus A becomes A. You have Saha plus Aham becomes Soham. And all Sandhis, you know, just went about it. So there are a number of Sanskrit grammar jokes. They keep happening in real life. So Mahabaho cannot be changed into Tathapitvam Mahabahaha, no. Mahabaho only. It is because it is not a sandhi at all. The word itself is Mahabaho. Naivam Shochito, O mighty armed, you should not cry, even if, though it is not true, even if let us say there is death. How? How come there also there is no reason to cry? Sri Krishna says, Jatasya hi dhruvo mrityuhu.
Jatasya hi dhruvo mrityuhu.
Dhruvam janma mrutasya cha.
Dhruvam janma mrutasya cha.
Tasmad aparihāryerthe.
Tasmad aparihāryerthe.
Natvam shochitum arhasi.
Natvam shochitum arhasi.
Jatasya hi dhruvo mrityuhu. Dhruvam janma mrutasya cha. Tasmad aparihāryerthe. Natvam
shochitum arhasi.
Avyaktadini bhutani.
Avyaktadini bhutani.
Vyaktamadhyani bharata.
Vyaktamadhyani bharata.
Avyaktanidhananyeva.
Avyaktanidhananyeva.
Tatraka paridevana.
Tatraka paridevana.
Avyaktadini bhutani. Vyaktamadhyani bharata. Avyaktanidhananyeva.
Tatraka paridevana.
Once more, combining great wisdom with sweet poetry, Veda Vyasa gives voice to Lord Sri Krishna, or gives, supplies words in a poetic form here. What we mean is, Lord Krishna may have not used the exact words, nor would he have given everything as shlokas. In his commentary, right in the introduction, Adi Shankaracharya says, Sri Krishna, who was an avatar of Vasudeva, Lord Vishnu, seeing that there was decline of dharma and increase of adharma in the world, recognized the need, burning need for reviving dharma. This I said the other day also. And said that if these teachings are given again to eminent people, then it would reach many more people. In fact, Shankaracharya, who was to an extent with orthodox Hindu religion, uses the expression, in addition to Arjuna being referred to as eminent, that he does explicitly say. He says there, in the short, very beautiful Avataranika, it is called, Avataranika Bhashya. Before even touching one shloka of Gita, he writes some 500 words, I think, or even less. Then he does not comment upon the whole first chapter. Lord Sri Adi Shankara has not commented on the first chapter at all. As though that is not enough, he does not comment upon the first 10 verses of the second chapter. He begins with 11th verse only. Many others have explained. If you see Madhusudana Saraswati's Bhashya, every shloka he has explained. Even some Panchajanyam Rishikeshaha, Devadattam Dhananjayaha, who blew which conch, that scene of Pandava army and Kaurava army, or if there is some name and you are not sure who that is, Madhusudana Saraswati or other commentators have taken pains to say, this is nobody than Mamaji of that other fellow, you know, relations. this person's son or that person's uncle. Because you want to understand the whole Gita, you would be interested. Some would be interested in those things only, not in the spiritual teachings. So one has to cater to all. Now coming back, Adi Shankara says, Brahma cha kshatrancha. This would cause a jitter to Dalits and especially some of those who are a bit extra sensitive to the caste issue. He says, if Brahmins and Kshatriyas are taught, if they come up, then the whole society comes up. So if you go about it with a little haste, then you would read into these lines, caste bias, Adi Shankaracharya also has prejudiced and so on. It is not so. It is rather, there are two ways to approach it. Number one, as we always do, don't take it as reference to caste by birth. Brahmacha kshatrancha meaning the educated people and the ruling class, those who are in administrative positions, because their influence on the society is much more. In today's corporate strategies also, sometimes you just cannot reach everybody. Then you say, we will reach this section, then it will spread to all. You select, you choose with no other agenda against others. Or even if you take it as reference to the Brahmins of his time and Kshatriyas of his time, one more explanation given there is, Shankaracharya did not mean to have any preference for X or Y, but those arrangements were given, those arrangements already existed. When you go to a European country, there are some structures there, some rules there, some culture there, some, you didn't create it. And then you have to, let us say, do some work, deliver a message and something like that within a limited time. And then you say, oh my, I wish I could go to everybody, Hispanics and blacks and whites, everybody. But I have been holed up here in this hotel and I have been given access to only some places, and day after tomorrow I have to fly back. Then you also would say, okay, I'll select in such a way some sections to whom I'll give a message, and then it will reach the maximum. So if it is taken out of context, it appears that you chose such and such people, as though you had an option to go to everybody, you didn't. So logistical limitations. Oh, anyway, Brahma cha kshatrancha. Why did that come, Shankaracharya's introduction? Yeah, before that, why did I get into? Mahabaho, after that when Jatasya hi Dhruvam iti. I said, what commentary? I think it came from, I do not say that there is death, but if you say, and accepting your position, I really do not accept. There I wanted to give another parallel situation. Adi Shankara doesn't accept any high or low with their Brahma Jnana, with the drishti that the same Brahman shines in all. He would not look at somebody as high and somebody else as low. But for in a given job and with logistical limitations, he has to discharge his duty. So the parallel is this. You see, which is the 26 and 27 we read now?
No. Started with that Vyasa concept of the shloka. Krishna must have not said in shloka.
Correct, that was the connection, yeah. Because this Atachayinam.
After chanting, only Swami started.
Ah, that's right. In a poetic as well as wise way, a blend of poetry and wisdom, I said. Then I said, Vyasa put it, yes, in the Avataranika Bhashya, where this Brahmakshatra also comes, then we went into that too. Adi Shankaracharya says, Sri Krishna taught Arjuna and then says, Veda Vyasa put those teachings of Sri Krishna into 700 shlokas. Sapta Shatabihi Shlokaihi Upanibandha, that is a line. Upanibandha is the putting them together. So if you ask, did Sri Krishna chant these 700 shlokas? He did not chant any shlokas. He might have taught in prose only. And it was the responsibility of Veda Vyasa, while enjoying the liberty of putting them in shlokas, he had to ensure that no injustice is done to the teachings. In your exuberance to make it very poetic, you should not put your own ideas there. You should say only what Sri Krishna said. Once in Bangalore, there were two elderly retired people who in fact were very devoted to this work, Swami Chinmayananji. In fact, one of them gave away his house in his will. Though I guess he had children, grandchildren, I don't know how he convinced them. He gave away his house to Chinmaya Mission, which is one Chinmaya center in South Bangalore now. So that he was a translator in those days. He and another gentleman, oh, very lovingly they translated a lot of Chinmayananji's works into Kannada. They were very good people, but one place they slightly slipped and they were caught. Not by me, I was around there. We had one Brahmachari, Nischal Chaitanyaji, who is now Nischal Ananda Swami, not with the mission, he is there around somewhere. So that Nischalji had good knowledge of scriptures and he was checking the translation. And then he suddenly saw that in one area where there is translation, Swamiji, Swami Chinmayananji is explaining the Bhagavad Gita shloka and Nischalji was checking the Kannada translation. Everything was okay. He was reading freely without even double checking with the original, because first you read in a general way, you get a sense whether it's okay. Then of course you have to check specifically also, first a free reading. In the free reading itself, he saw that there were references to some Kannada poetry, as Kanakadasa has said, and 2-3 shlokas of Kanakadasa, 2-3 poetic lines. Then Nischalji said, how can Chinmayananji quote Kannada poetry? Suppose I write a commentary on Gita, and in between profusely I am quoting several Gujarati, you know, padya, doha bolte hain abhi, some doha, as Narsi Mehta has said, and 3-4 have written. Vaishnava Janato is very well known, that is understandable. Gandhiji se aur gaya waha se liya, some well known, that belongs to the whole country. But some less known poetry of Gujarati, then anybody would say, mamla gadbad hai. How can Chidananji quote Gujarati poetry? So they found, then they said, wait a minute, they saw the original. Has Swamiji quoted Kanakadasa? There was no mention of Kanakadasa at all. Though it was very appropriate, in fact there was some fight after that on that. So, I was sort of a witness because I was very junior that time. I was around there. So they were called and they were said, what is this? We thought you are doing a very faithful translation. You are putting some things of your own. You like Kanakadasa and you. But they said, no, but yeah. So Gurudev has not quoted Kanakadasa. But we thought it fits very well. It is very appropriate. In fact, we both of us have discussed between each other. We thought that by putting Kanakadas here, Kanakadas is a Kannada poet, a Krishna Bhakta, you know. By putting Kanakadas and some of his poems here, we thought we would be improving or increasing the value of Gurudev's commentary. They argued like that, and this Nishchalji had some short temper also. He screamed at them, "No, you have no business, translators have no business to put in something which is not said in the original. You have some freedom with the word, you know, which is the appropriate word, or you can sometimes take some idioms also, you know, while translating to express the same bhava, same meaning, you may use an idiom of English. If you are too literal, sometimes the translation loses its charm. You can take some liberty in language, words, idioms, and so on. Like there is an idiom in English, a stitch in time saves nine. So the someone has written, let us say in Gujarati, something which means if you act in time, a lot of problems will be solved or will be prevented. So to translate it, you may use the English idiom because this is what it means. But you cannot quote something which is not said at all. But they were a bit hurt also. They were angry, and you don't trust, you don't use, how many hours we have spent on this, all that. That means emotions came up. So Vyasa, we come back properly, Veda Vyasa. Veda Vyasa, we have reason to believe, because he was a Sarvajna, he was a mighty, highly gifted person. He would not run short of ideas or words. He is not short of resources. The big mighty brain, Namostu Te Vyasa, Vishala Buddhe, Vishala Buddhi, literally. So he was successful in expressing all that Sri Krishna had said in poetic Sanskrit as per meter. And the change of meter, like right now, next shloka, 29 is a different meter. Trishtup. In Bhagavad Gita, out of 700, maybe almost 600 are in Anushtup. But about 100 are in Trishtup. Each pada, quarter, has 11 syllables in Trishtup. But majority, which are in Anushtup, have 8 syllables in each quarter. Dharma kshetre kuru kshetre 8, sama veta yu yutsavaha 8, mama ka pandavaschaiva 8, kima kurvata sanjaya 8, 600 verses you can check are all in Anushtup, but some 100, maybe less than 100 are in Trishtup. If you count here, Ascharyavat paschati kaschidenam, it is 11. Ascharyavat vadati tathaiva chanyaha is 11. And this is called Chandas Shastra, prosody or prosody, I don't know what it is. How do you pronounce it? Anyone knows that word? We Indians sometimes know exact spelling, but we don't know correct pronunciation. Because it's not so much spoken. We read a lot, speak only half as much, and hear very little of accent free English in our country. Wherever you go, you hear English with some accent of the region, regional accents. Anyway, Chanda Shastra. So I'll complete this point with the mention that Vyasa changes meter also, being faithful to Lord Krishna's teachings. This doesn't mean Lord Krishna changed meter. He didn't sing poetry at all. But meter and change of meter many a time is the shift of mood, shift of spirit, a shift of bhava. sometimes it also signifies a jerky shift of topic, and writers employ a new meter to bring about that shift in the reader. If the reader while reading gets a bit bored, a change of meter wakes him up. And leave alone, that is reader's subjective problem. But in what has to be expressed as poetry, in what has to be delivered, the message to be delivered also may have a shift in intensity, in the nature of topic and so on. So this is how in commentaries sometimes we find the change of meter is to signify the beginning of a new theme, new topic and so on, such things they write. So we read, which one did we read now? Yeah, 27 and 28. This is an 27 is an explanation on why, even if let us take for granted, let us imagine that there is death, even in that case you should not cry. Why? How come? The reason is, it is inevitable. When something is utterly inevitable, wise people would not cry over it. Day follows night and night follows day. Does any person with even a little common sense cry, oh, again it is evening, I thought today there will be no evening? Nobody would say that. After morning there would be afternoon, after afternoon there would be evening, then there would be night. Nobody would cry. There was some daughter-in-law, I believe, in some house, very wonderful, her mother-in-law told me, very wonderful girl, absolutely, we are lucky to have such a daughter-in-law, but she has one peculiar habit. The joint family of good old days, she makes the best coffee every morning, but we can hear her saying, oh, I have to make coffee again. She sings that tune and then makes coffee and serves everybody. So she had that habit, maybe she picked up. Like I had a cousin who was like that. You ask her, what is the time? She says, time to close your lecture, she says. Let's say she says it is 5:20. But before saying it is 5:20, she would say, there is the clock, can you not see? 5:20 it is. If you really are angry, don't tell. Or if you are not angry, tell it is 5:20. Pyar se. But she had a peculiar habit. Anyone asks her for any information, little bit frets and fumes, and ab khud nahi dekh sakte diwar par hai ghadi, theek hai 5:20 hua, like that. So except for some of these habits where one doesn't really mean anything, by and large nobody complains about day turning into night or the seasons and many things which are bound to happen. They are called aparihārya artha. Parihārya is where you can do something about it. Aparihārya is where nothing can be done about it. What cannot be prevented has to be accepted. I heard it endured. Endure what you cannot prevent. Many versions perhaps. So, aparihārya arthe natvam shochitum arhasi, for this is a very much quoted shloka, jātasya hi dhruvo mrityuh, one that is born has to die. Dhruvo mrityu, dhruvam janma mrityasya cha, and one that dies has to be born, no choice. This is the law, and why fret and fume about the law of nature? Avyaktadini bhutani, even on that plane where you are able to see things, you are not able to see a deeper plane, no problem. Even on the plane which you are able to see, please note that all living beings appear in the middle, vyakta madhyani, madhya means middle, vyakta is expressed. They are manifest in the middle, otherwise avyakta adi. In the beginning they are unmanifest and avyakta nidhana. After their death again they are unmanifest. It is not true that they do not exist, but we do not see them. It is like an arrow coming from darkness, but in the middle it is shining. And before even you figure out what is this, it has gone back into darkness. Though you see it only in the middle, it was before, it is before, it is afterwards also. In the middle, it is visible. Avyaktadini bhutani vyakta madhyani bharata avyakta nidhanani eva. This being the case, all this being law of nature, tatra ka paridevana. Paridevana is grief, complaint, sorrow, crying, weeping, whatever way you translate. Translators have liberty in choosing one of 10 words, whichever seems to them to be appropriate. But you cannot add, why do you cry and why do you make your wife also cry? That is not said in the shloka. You cannot justify it saying, but it fits very well in the context and so on. That is your subjective choice. Tatra ka paridevana. So such lines also are very, very universally applicable. Tatra ka paridevana. Like a saying it is, or like a manner of saying, not only in this context, somewhere else also. You know, you miss your train somewhere, and then you can say to yourself, sometimes we do miss trains, tatra ka paridevana, you may say. Om Shanti 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 Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om.